morning, welcome.
Good morning.
And the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Grace and peace to us all. In the name of Christ our Lord, he bids us come to this time of worship to know the presence of the risen Christ as we gather at his feet. He meets us here. He blesses us. We are blessed by the presence of each of you, especially those guests who may be with us. Thank you for sharing your worship at First Church this morning, and remind us all of the registration pass. Family and our views can also help us to know you sharing your worship. As we share in worship, we also wish to lift up the announcements as we find them. Yesterday, we were blessed to share in the ministry, food bank, and clothes closet, as we do each third Saturday. As we did so, we served 91 households, packed 129 boxes, and served 325 of our neighbors. So thank you all for sharing that ministry. We're grateful for the help of the Methodist that they love as well. As we move into this week, a meeting of our stewardship committee tomorrow afternoon, and a reminder that each Tuesday and Thursday we share the ministry of lunch, and you see before you the opportunity to volunteer for that ministry as well. This afternoon at 3 o'clock will be a cluster charge conference at Stanleytown Church. This has been called by our superintendent, Janine Howard, to get churches together to share ideas for ministry. We're gathered together to share a conversation about best practices in ministry. That is open to all, so I'll have to be there at 3 o'clock. It should go about 90 minutes, and again, that invitation is before us all at 3 o'clock at Stanleytown Church. Many of us will also share in this the opportunity with us as well. Thank you.
Let us worship God together.
Lord God of heaven and earth,
creator of our world,
and everything in it,
holy is your name. In you we live and move and have our being. We are your Lord's children, the work of your hands. We pray that your Holy Spirit will move among us as we worship. Awaken our eyes to your presence. Awaken our ears to your word. Receive the worship of our hearts. Thank you.
Paul, standing in the middle of the Areopagus, said, "Men of Athens, I perceive that in every way you are very religious. For as I passed along and observed the objects of your worship, I found also an altar with this inscription to an unknown God. What therefore you worship as unknown, and this I proclaim to you, the God who made the world and everything in it, being Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in shrines made by man, nor is he served by human hands as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all men life and breath everything. And he made from one every nation of men to live on all the face of the earth, having determined a lot of periods and boundaries of their habitation, that they should seek God in the hope that they might feel after him and find him. Yet he is not far from each one of us. For in him we live, move, and have our being, as even some of your poets have said, for we are indeed his offspring. Being then God's offspring, we ought not to think that the deities like God are silver or stone, a representation by the art and imagination of man. In the times of ignorance, God overlooked, but now he commands all men everywhere to repent, because he has fixed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed. And of this he has given assurance to all men, by raising him from the dead. Now when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked, but others said, "We will hear you again about this." So Paul went out from among them, but some men joined him and believed, among them Dionysius the Areopagite, and a woman named Damaris, and others with them. This is the word of our Lord.
Thank you.
1967, the classic movie Cool Hand Luke played in theaters across the country. If we did not see the movie then, chances are good we've seen it on TV during one of its frequent airings. This movie, starring Paul Newman and George Kennedy, tells the story of a petty criminal named Luke Jackson. Luke is sentenced to 2 years on a Florida prison farm. Luke is far from a model prisoner, infuriating in particular the prison warden, better known as the captain. There are many memorable scenes in this movie, but I'm going to eat the hard-boiled eggs here. But one scene in particular comes to mind this morning. It is a scene in which the captain becomes especially enraged at comments made by Luke. He is so enraged, he violently strikes Luke across the back, sending a shackled Luke rolling downhill. Surprising himself and surrounding inmates by this sudden burst of rage, the captain tries to gather himself to justify to himself and the surrounding witnesses what he has just done. He does so by calmly but defiantly announcing, "What we've got here is there to communicate." Thank you, I'll be back later. Well, this is a classic movie line, and it's no wonder why. It's classic, I suspect, because these words apply to many areas of our lives at many times. To put it another way, is there any area of our lives in which we have not known a failure to communicate? Shortly after arriving in Martinsville, I heard of and experienced problems with what is known as silo mentality in Martinsville, Denver County. This silo mentality, you may know, speaks of how numerous institutions, government agencies, schools, service organizations, churches, often function as if they operate within silos, that is, not reaching out to one another, not engaging in basic communication with each other, even when doing so to benefit each other and the community. Each day as we watch the news, we are reminded of communication problems ranging from the White House to local government. We know even the church is not immune from failure to communicate. When is that meeting? Who's on the committee? I thought we were going to lock up the building. I didn't know I was supposed to bring refreshments. Even within our homes. You said you were going to be home at 6 o'clock. Dinner's been ready over an hour. I didn't say I'd be home at 6 o'clock. I said I had to pick up the car at 6 o'clock, but it wasn't ready yet, so I had to wait. Well, you could have called. I could have, but I didn't want to bother you in the middle of something. I didn't think I would be that late. I worked all day on it. Now it's got cold. Well, I'm sorry. I'm okay warming it up. But you said you'd be home at 6. That never happens in our home.
Sports leagues and
travel teams and civic obligations, Paul still encountered great competition when proclaiming the gospel. Paul was also wise enough to know that everyone, regardless of time or place, believes in something. In fact, we see this in the story from the book of Acts. Written by the same writer who gives us the Gospel of Luke, Acts begins with Jesus ascending into heaven, then shares with us the birth of the church on the day of Pentecost. Then unfolding before us is the work of the followers of Jesus as they communicate the gospel throughout the world around the Mediterranean Sea. It is this setting leading us to Paul sharing the gospel in Athens, Greece, in the middle of the Areopagus, an impressive rock formation also known as Martinsville. Paul begins by recognizing the beliefs of those gathered before him. He has already observed Athens as a city full of idols, has already entered into conversation with a number of philosophers. So he begins, "Men of Athens, I perceive that in every way you are very religious. For as I passed along and observed the objects of your worship, I found also an altar with this inscription to an unknown god, just in case we missed it." So understand, in such a way, Paul begins to communicate the gospel of Christ. But I wonder if we have known this story is in our Bible. I wonder because I believe it true that as we consider the sharing of the gospel, the stories coming to our minds frequently are not stories like this one. Instead, sad to say, the stories we know regarding the sharing of the gospel frequently are stories giving Christian witness a bad name. They are stories taking the most blessed of words, evangelism, casting a terrible shadow over it. You know the stories of which I speak. Someone trying to scare us into heaven. Crude and ugly tracks left on windshields. Accounts of the fires of hell. The ominous question, are you saved? We know these stories and been party to these experiences, so unfortunately we have had our views of sharing the gospel tainted. We notice these are stories of which Paul will have no part. Look again at Paul's approach to sharing the gospel. Do we see how Paul respects those who hear him? Do we see how Paul flatters those to whom he speaks? Do we see how he does not judge, does not condemn those who believe differently than he believes? Do we see how Paul finds common ground with those with whom he speaks? Of how he, in essence, says, "I am a believer, you are believers. With this common behavior of belief, may I share with you what I believe." Do we see how Paul is not so much concerned with what he says, but with what his audience hears? Brothers and sisters, there is a difference. You see, if I am more concerned with what I say than what you hear, then what I say is directed toward being an impressive word to create a desire to feed my ego. But if the greater concern is with what you hear, then the orientation is different. Then the sharing of the message begins with you. Your context, your history, factor into shaping and sharing the message. The words are chosen with the intent you hear and receive. The message is not concerned with the ego of the speaker, but out of respect for those who hear. What is heard is more important. What is said. And Paul, in the middle of the Areopagus, speaking to those of Athens, knows this. Paul understands the gospel begins at the ear, not at the mouth. So he offers no tracts, no Roman road to salvation, no asking of, "Are you saved?"
Instead, it's a message in which Paul cares for his audience, wishes for them to know the good news he knows, for them to know the life he knows, for them to walk in the light in which he now walks.
In a recent article for the magazine Christian Century, writer, speaker, and communications expert, writes regarding this scripture, "I've always found it strangely refreshing that Paul chooses not to ram the gospel down the Athenians' throats. He speaks about the essential aspects of belief in Christ without naming names, without embellishing life through rose-tinted glasses, and without using scare tactics. Yet the message is still crystal clear. God created humanity serve and worship Him alone, the one true God, through Christ the resurrected Savior." And regarding faith-based fiction, she comments, "I prefer mainstream fiction because it reminds me that life, even as a Christian, is lived out here on earth with real people, Christians and non-Christians, who disappoint and hurt us and whom we also disappoint and hurt. And these stories remind me that Christians do not live in a bubble, that part of being a Christian is continuing to find ways to witness to the truth of life in Christ in a language people outside of church will understand." Well, you and I gather this morning as the United Methodist because of the faithfulness to God of a man named John Wesley. Wesley was a priest in the Church of England, accustomed early in his life preaching within impressive places of worship, accustomed to sharing the gospel within the walls of the church to those who already know. In time, he was led to share the gospel with those who worked outside in the fields, with coal miners, with those in prison, to preach to the Areopagus, to those of Athens. Central to this ministry were these words of John Wesley: "Though we cannot think the light, may we not love the light. May we not be of one heart, though we are not of one opinion. Without all doubt, we may. Herein all the children of God may unite, notwithstanding these smaller differences." Well, Wesley knows, as does the Apostle Paul, that the heart, the life of each of us created within the image of God, is our desire to be at peace with God. Paul knows, Wesley knows, that the heart of the life of each of us created in the likeness of God is our desire for our relationship with God to be healed. Everyone here is on a search for God. Everyone here wants to find the one whom we search. And we know the words of St. Augustine to be true: "Our hearts are restless, O Lord, until they find their rest in You." We know the words of the 20th century man of the church, Paul, tell it to be true: "There is within each one of us a faint recollection of Eden. That is, each of us recalls that time when we were at peace with the one who made us, and our deepest desire is to be at such a place of peace again." That's why we're here. So hear this good news, shared with you this day. The good news that He made for one every nation to live on all the face of the earth, that they should seek God, in the hope that they might feel after Him and find Him, yet He is not far from each one of us. I invite us to stand as we respond to the word, as we affirm our faith with the modern affirmation, number 885. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is the one true church. And We're called to be a people of prayer, to be those who ask, seek, pray without ceasing. So we pray, sharing our responsive time of prayer known as the prayers of the people. With this pattern of prayer, I remain in various positions, including each of the words, Lord, in your mercy, and inviting you to respond, hear our prayer, inviting you to name those concerns, persons, circumstances you would like to speak to God as we pray. As Christ has called us in conclusion. You go to God as we pray. Lord, we remember we are here because there were those who faithfully, obediently shared with us the good news. Those who made known your love to us, those who affirmed us and blessed us because they loved you and loved us. We give you thanks for those who have shared the good news. We give you thanks for this opportunity to share the good news. We pray as we go from this place, we would represent you, reveal your love for all you have made, that all we meet may know of your love, may know the grace of Christ, and may know your desire to be in relationship, to be healed. All you have made. Lord, in your mercy, hear us, Lord, as we pray for the people of this congregation. Lord, in your mercy. Here's as we pray for your world, its peoples, and its leaders. Lord, in your mercy. Here's, Lord, as we pray for your church, its leaders, its members, and its mission. Lord, in your mercy. God Father.